Blackstone Publishing presents The Walking Tour by Kathryn Davis. This book is read by Elisabeth Rodgers. For Louise. Part 1. Quick and Dirty. The end of all things is nigh. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. And above all things have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. 1 Peter, chapter 4, verses 7 through 8. Time passed. Or at least that's one way to get from there, my famous mother's infamous summer in Wales, to here, the ruined house and acreage she used to call home. Darling, begins a postcard of vine-draped Tintern Abbey in the moonlight. As you can see, despite Dr. Minton's dire warnings, I haven't left behind what Bobby calls my horror vacui. The faces should be recognizable, though disguised as bees. Her name was Carole Ridingham, even after she married my father, Robert Rose, or Bobby, as he liked to be called, the way Napoleon preferred the little corporal. Bobby was the founder and original CEO of Snow White and Rose Red, a powerful man, and hot in the vernacular, unlike my mother, who eventually swelled up with the change and never came back down. But she was a genius, it didn't matter. As for the faces, deliriously inked into any leftover space on the card, front and back, they include Ruth Farr's and her husband Coleman's, the Snow of Snow White, and owe a lot to the portraits Blake drew of his friends, with flea heads, etc., that my mother made a point of seeing at the Tate while Bobby flirted with waitresses, and my so-called Aunt Ruth recorded her every move in her journal, and my so-called Uncle Coleman snapped photos covertly like a spy. The women's agendas may have been more overt, but don't be fooled. The men had agendas too, not the least of which was to figure out what to do with all the money they made 5 years earlier when they sold the business. Everyone has an agenda, me included. Though we've been repeatedly reminded that the past's off limits except to seers. Eyes straight ahead. Let the dead wake the dead, as the saying goes. The dire warnings refer to my mother's mental condition. At 13, she was diagnosed borderline schizophrenic and was put on drugs that made her thrust her tongue from her mouth in a way that looked less like a tongue than a nose, especially when she was trying to concentrate. My poor doomed mother, either sailing away from me across the meadow in her white beekeeping gloves and veil, in which case I couldn't see the tongue, or painting in the garden house she used as a studio, in which case I could, but just barely, my view hampered by the gooseberry bushes outside the window, and Bobby, who usually tried to keep me out. He said he was protecting her, but we all knew better. He was keeping her to himself, which I think was how he thought he could make sure she'd be his forever. Aside from the tongue, I almost never saw signs of what was referred to as inappropriate behavior. Later, we'd have dinner prepared by Mrs. Coop, our humorless cook, and served by some cute-faced and inept maid. Deluxe treatment, even then. A long, honey-colored table polished with beeswax and lit with beeswax candles, at each place one of the ever-so-subtly unmatched blue willow plates, and above the sideboard the plangent reds and golds and deep umbers of 492. My God. Bœuf en daube, mushrooms and pearl onions, petit pois, creme brulee. In those days, we ate like kings. Eventually, 492, the number of objects in the painting, got confiscated along with smaller and darker 53 that used to hang above my parents' bed. My mother said I was counting like a bank teller when I told her I couldn't find more than 49. I'll never forget the smell in that room. Witch hazel, honey, wet dirt. Out the window, the silver light of the Maine seacoast, and on the bed, Uncle Tony sitting with his head in his arms, sobbing. But that came later.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.